start. So this class we are continuing our discussion on the forced vibration. Repeating again, forced vibration, the differential equation will be in the form of x double dot plus 2c omega n x dot plus omega n square x, that is equal to the function of time t. This f as a function of time t can have a different possibilities. Now we are taking a simple harmonically applied force, so that is f cos omega t with a constant magnitude. So this entire equation is divided by m, so you got this. So yesterday we solved this. This particular thing has two parts. One is the complementary part, or that is a transient function that will be applicable for the initial period. So after that, the second part of the solution, that is the particular integral, the steady state solution will come. So we have derived it a formidable equation for the value of x, the displacement. So that equation can be looked at in a simple way of the what is called a phasor or vectors. So each term can be looked at as the vector, then the right hand side will be the resultant of this, that is nothing but xs by x, that is your inverse of q. So this is going to be 1 by q. Q is the dynamic magnification factor. Q is a dynamic magnification factor. So we have got this. So you have to look at this inverse of this particular thing to plot what is called as the frequency response of a second order or mass spring dance system. This one is called a frequency response. So it is an important graph as per the engineering is concerned, not only in mechanical engineering or spring mass damper system. Even if you take an electrical engineering, when you are dealing the equivalent system of a resistor, capacitor and inductor, when you are having a resistor, capacitor, inductor, also the differential equation for such system will also be like this, because it's also a second order system. So you have this curve is a very important curve called a frequency response curve. So that is here the x-axis, the excitation frequency is changed, but it is not given directly in terms of frequency, but it is given as the dimensionless number of omega by omega n. In the y-axis you have the amplitude of vibration, but not amplitude of vibration straight away, it is again a dimensionless number of x by xs. Xs is the static deflection and capital X is the dynamic deflection or amplitude of vibration. These are the things we have already seen. So here if you look at this particular graph, so what this represents, this particular thing represents, you know, it is all divided by omega n square. So this is the term connected with omega n square. So this is your spring. So this represented this particular one term, you know, the there are three forces which are coming in a spring mass damper system. If you look at, you have three elements, that is a spring, mass and a damper. So these three systems, the forces coming out of the forces exerted by all the three are equal to the resultant force, that is the external force which is applied. So there is an external force is applied over here. So The three forces, the force from the spring, force from the dashboard, inertial force of the mass will be equal to the external force that is applied. So that is what these four vectors mean. So out of these four vectors, this one represents what? So if you look at it, this one comes by dividing the entire equation by omega n square. So you look at this particular term, what is connected to omega n, that is your spring force. So this is the spring force, this is related to spring force. And you have 2c omega by omega n. You look at the term 2c omega comes from the damper. So the spring force is proportional to the displacement. Damper force is proportional to the velocity. And this one omega by omega n square. So this term. So here you have this that is related to the mass. So you have the three elements, and this net is related to the net force that is being applied. Okay, so this is what this thing means. So now we are going to draw this so called frequency response, the most important graph, using this particular the vector polygon itself. Okay, so let us take some important points. We will note it down here. So this is, say, omega by omega n is equal to 1. So here you have this as 1, then you can take it as, say, 2, 3, 4, 5, like that it can go up. So here you have 1, 2, like this. So if you to do this graph, we have already started yesterday. Let us do it a little bit again, no problem. Now I will assume this as, for this graph, I'll assume that for the entire thing I'm going to draw this frequency response. I'm going to draw for C is equal to 0.1. That is, it is an underdamped system. I'm taking that C is equal to 0.1. So already I have calculated this thing, as I told you, when it is 0, when this omega by 1 omega n is 0. So initially let me draw this unity vector 1, no problem. Then, so this is at an angle omega t minus epsilon. Now when it comes to the next term, that is 2c omega by omega n, your omega by omega n is 0, so this term will be 0. 2c omega omega n will be 0. Then the next term, which is acting in the opposite direction, is also 0. So omega by omega n is also 0. Therefore, what happens is that your the two vectors which are like this are all 0. So therefore, your force, the other one x, s by x is also equal to 1. So your xx by x is also equal to 1. Therefore, the inverse is also equal to 1. So dynamic magnification factor is the inverse of this. So that is equal to 1. So my first point, when this is 0, the first point will be here. So that is the first point. So when you are asked to draw this frequency response curve, you can always, you know, go step by step. Few points you located, then things will come smoothly. So first point to be located is 1. So that means when the force is applied statically, 0 frequency means statically, the deflection will also be a static deflection. Dynamic deflection is also equal to static deflection. This term becomes 1. Now if I increase this omega by omega n, then what happens is this particular term will increase, that is 2c omega by omega n will increase, and the other part will also increase, omega by omega n square also will increase. Then you have the resultant vector here, the resultant, that is x, s by x, the inverse of q will be there. It will not be 1, but it will be less than 1. The inverse of that will be more than 1. So you have points coming up here like this. So we have already discussed that in the last class. So when you go nearer to 1, we have seen that this goes for this particular case as high as 5. So somewhere here you have another point. So this goes like this. So after that, so there is a critical thing, like when omega by omega n equal to 1, we will draw this figure. So you should be able to draw this. So let me take up something like this. You have 1, 2c omega by omega n, this will be equal to 2c. We are talking about when omega by omega n is equal to 1. So then the square also will become 1. So in this case, this resultant also will be, that is xx by x, is also will be equal to 2c. So it is a 0.1 as we assume. So it is going to be 0.2. So 1 by 0.2 will be equal to 5. That is how we get it. So this is a particular thing. Now, if I increase this omega by omega n further, that is beyond 1 if I increase, then what will happen is, so this is what will be the result. So this will go up as it is 2c omega by omega n. Now this will be more than 1. So you will have something like this. So the resultant will be like this. So this is, it is again, it has increased. This is 1 by q. So this has increased more than that. So the inverse of it will be less. So you will have this coming down. That is, as you increase, it will come down. So if typical value, if I take, if I increase it further, for example, if I take is 1.5, if it is 1.5, this is say, if I take it as 1.5, what will be the value of this will be 0.3. 2c omega by omega n will be something like 0.3. Then as I calculated this, omega by omega n square will be 2.25. That will be 2.25, then what you will get is this, that is your resultant. You see that the polygon is different now, not the same way. So for that, this will be 1.28 times. So your inverse of that will be 0.777. So when it is 1.5 here, this comes to this particular place, 0.777, like that. So it is going to be less than 1 now. So as you keep on increasing this omega by omega ratio, this will also increase and this will also further increase. So as this particular term increases, it is going to be less than 1. Again, as you proceed further and further, you will see that it goes like this. So this is a plot that you can get. So if you connect all these things, it will be a curve like this. This will be a curve like this. So this is my frequency response. So now it is what you call is this is a frequency response. You can see that the starting point when force is applied statically, it is x by x is 1, but as you increase, it goes and reaches a maximum value. If I increase it further, it is not going to increase further, rather that it will start decreasing. And you see that after some time, after a certain frequency, it goes beyond 1. Then it goes further, you know, it goes the asymptotically, this it goes to 0. So it will go in that fashion. So this is the behavior or for frequency response of a second order system. You have any doubt? This is a very important curve. You should be able to draw this curve properly, because here you see the starting point is 1, it goes up nearly at 1, you know, you get the maximum, not 1, please watch my word, it is nearly 1, because we are going to prove that it's not going to be exactly 1, it is some other value. Okay, nearly when it is 1, it goes to maximum, then as you further increase this omega by omega, it proceeds down like this. So what this curve means to me practically is, I don't have anything to show right now, I'll try to arrange, but what it means this is, I am increasing the excitation frequency. That means if I switch, for example, I take a table fan, some table fan like this, then you have rotating blades. So the unbalance in rotating blades will be your the vibration source. So as you the speed increases, the excitation frequency also will increase. So when you switch on the fan from zero speed, if the fan speed is slowly increasing, that means you are moving on the x-axis like this, towards this, when the speed is increasing. So when this particular frequency of excitation matches with the natural frequency of the support, the fan is supported on the structure, if that texture natural frequency and the excitation frequency matches, that means it's close to 1 here, then you will have a greater amplitude. But that is not going to be sustained, because as the frequency omega of this increases, then you are not going to stay here, you are going to move away from this, then the fan gets smoothened. Okay, so this indicates that when the fan speed increases slowly, you are moving from zero to this side. You are going to, this vibrate, this texture is going to go through this curve. The vibration of this is going to go through this curve. But there is also another thing, if I am pausing this quickly, then you may not be able to see that response. So that is what happens when I switch on the fan, this, the speed picks up so fast that this curve quickly crosses over. You may not be able to see the resonant. But when you switch off the fan, the deceleration of the fan is going to take place on its own. So the reverse is going to take place. The high speed is going to come down and stop. At that time, the frequency is going to traverse along this. That's going to happen in a much slower fashion. There you can see that fan structure is shaking. So that is the, not only for the fan, it is for the, for any system, any motor, any machinery, when you switch on or switch off, you are going to, the structure is going to pass through this curve. But what is important is, what is important here as an engineer is, you should not be operating your system in this region. Very dangerous. So why I study all this thing? One of the important reason why I study this is because I should not be operating this at this region. Okay, so if I operate, my operating point is here, what will happen is, this vibration will, if it is, you know, greater the deflection, this means greater x means your structure is going to deflect, the deflections are more, so if you sustain that, the stresses created will be more, then your system will fail. Okay, so we will be discussing anyway, there is the effect of resonance. This is called, this region or close to one, we call it the resonance. Another point is, like, unless I am interested in creating larger vibration, do not operate in the resonance region. Okay, so if I operate in the resonance region, your structure is going to fail. So that is a very, very key important point. So that is, we will show you the video of a bridge which collapsed. That's called Tacoma Narrows Bridge. That bridge collapsed because of the vibrations excited by the wind flow. It was not the hurricane or something like that. It was a normal wind flow, about 50 kilometers per hour. Gentle blow only. The vibration excited by that the wind flow has created, that happens to be in the natural frequency of the bridge. So the bridge which was built using steel and concrete collapsed like something, you know, made up of fragile material, collapses and fell down. So that is the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. So people have found that is in Washington State. So after going through that the incident, they have analyzed, they found that the bridges needs to be taken care of so-called self-excited vibrations by the wind blow. So there was a this thing. So after that they designed, now they designed the bridge so that the vertices created by the wind blow is taken care of. Okay, so that we will discuss separately in the topic of self-excited vibrations. So resonance, so one of the primary rule for an engineer is avoid operating your machine in resonance. What about your washing machine? You can also see in washing machine, when the spinning takes place in washing machine, you know, it will, when you switch off that machine, you know, it will shake up at a particular speed, again it will come down. So these are all the phenomena that you can explain related to this resonance. You have any doubt, please? Now we have to see, this is a graph for one value of C, one damping value, damping ratio. If I do this for higher damping ratio or lower damping ratio, how this will look like? So if I take that C is less, if the C is less, what will happen is, it will all start with 1, but you will see that when the C is reduced to 0.05, then it will go up like this. If C is technically 0, theoretically C is 0, then you will see that this goes to infinity. So C is 0 means totally undamped vibrations. If an undamped system, if you operate it at the resonant range, it will go to infinite amplitude. That means it is going to fail. So to fail a system, the otherwise, if you want to break a structure with a less effort, what you do is you operate with resonance. So if the if you want to you know, bring down a building, so what they will do is they will use a pendulum type of a hammer. So that will hit it at a particular frequency, low frequency. The big structure means a lower frequency. I hit it at a lower frequency, then it will build up, and with a less effort it will collapse. Okay, so as I told you, any engineering, any phenomena, engineers exploit it. If I want to collapse it, operate it at the resonance. If I don't want, if I want to protect it, skip the resonance region. Okay, so these are the things. Now if I increase the C value, that is damping value is increased. Yeah. If it is? Yeah, yeah, what is that? I said that civil structures will have a very low natural frequency. What is the reason? Because you know that omega n is root of lambda by m. So huge mass, civil structure means huge mass. Huge mass means this omega n will be less, isn't it? So the stiffness, is you cannot increase the stiffness of concrete or this thing immediately, but the huge mass means the omega n is less. That's why I told you, you know, the bridge, the buildings may have a frequency about 1 or 2 hertz. So you just use a hammer to hit it at that particular frequency, you will see that it vibrates and collapses. Okay? Otherwise, I have to give greater effort to do that. If I hammer it at that natural frequency, then it will collapse. So that's the idea. Because a similar structure has greater mass, so in mechanical, mass will be less, your stiffness will be more, so they will operate at higher frequency. The natural frequency of mechanical structures, like if you take a machine, a bed and all that, it will be in the order of say few kilohertz, whereas this will be in the order of few hertz, very very low natural frequency. Any other thing? Now when the C is, yesterday asked why not it is infinity. It is the peak amplitude is decided by the damping ratio. Okay? If it is zero, the damping ratio is zero, that means totally undamped remains will go to infinity. Otherwise, it will be of a particular value. Now, if the C value is less, for example, C value is 1, that is critically damped, the response would be something like this. If the C value is less, the C value is, this is the value for C is equal to 1. You see that the amplitude never goes above 1, it is always less than 1. So there is a rule number 2 for controlling the vibration. Rule number the 1 of controlling the vibration is avoid operating resonant region. Rule number 2 of controlling the vibrations is increase the damping. If you increase the damping, then you will not have this problem. So the amplitude, all these things will come down. So there is one case where in a 5-star hotel in Delhi, because I have attended number of programs related to the vibration, they say they are case studies. So in one of the 5-star hotels in Delhi, there was a within the night, you know, there will be a disco dance or a night this thing parties. So during that they beat the drum. So the sound will be very, very loud. They observed that the glass panels installed there, you know, breaks quite often. Because of this drumming up sound and all that, it happens to be matching with the resonance, this break. So what is the thing they have is, they have no control over, you know, they cannot ask the customer to say that don't beat up like this because our glasses are coming down. So you cannot do that. So what they have to manage is somehow they have to protect the glass. So only option given by the consultant is, we cannot do any change except increase the damping. So what they did is, they tried first with increasing damping by sticking the band-aid tapes. So you have band-aid tapes by Johnson & Johnson, you know, wherever you are cut, they put the tape. So they stuck the tape on this, they found that it is effective. Then after that, what they did is, they brought in their the so-called interior designer. So he intelligently modified, you know, these stickers. They developed, you know, some kind of the stickers of, you know, the various figures, cartoon figures, and that they stuck it on the glass panel. So when they stuck that on the glass panel, it looked elegant, but at the same time it was doing this damping. Okay, both they have got. So they were able to protect the glasses. Okay, so that is how they have to operate. So the damping ratio plays an important role in controlling the vibration. So another thing is, avoid resonance. Rule number 2 is, avoid resonance. Any doubt? Now, this we will look at, you know, the I told that this resonant, that is a peak, can happen nearly at 1. But what exactly it will be? Will it be exactly 1 or it will be a different value? That we can find out by differentiating this Q with respect to omega by omega n. Okay? So if I differentiate it, I can find out the exact value at which the Q becomes max. So your Q is equal to, you know, if you remember that it is 1 minus omega by omega n square, whole square, plus 2c omega by omega n square to the power of minus half. So this equation looks difficult to remember, but you don't have to worry at all, because when you write this equation, if you bring in that particular vector polygon, you know that this is the first term of the right angle triangle, this is the second one, height of this, the square root of this, or Q is 1 by this by minus. So you have to find out this dq by d of omega by omega n and equate that equal to 0, then you may find that what omega by omega n, the Q will be max. So now if I differentiate it, this is half of 1 minus omega by omega n square, the whole square, plus, so let me say that 4 c square omega by omega n square. I didn't do anything except writing this to the power minus 3 by 2 into, now I differentiate what is inside, so I will have 2 times 1 minus omega by omega n, then into minus half, so this is square, minus half 2 times omega by omega n, plus 4 c square into 2 times omega by omega n. So this is a dq by d omega by d, d by d omega by omega n. So this should be equal to 0 to find out what point your q will be max. The first term, so if this is the product of these two terms, that is equal to 0. If either of the term is 0, then your final product also will be 0. But if I take the first term, then if this first term is 0, if I say that first term is 0, because of which the whole term becomes 0, then this product is 0, means if we go back to the original function, that itself will be 0. Isn't it? This term, it goes exactly here. If I say this is 0, the whole Q itself is 0. That is a trivial case. Q itself is 0. And one more argument is that this term, you look at these two terms, or they are squares. So omega by omega n is definitely a positive quantity. So it may go above 1 also in cases. So this term may become negative, but square of that will be positive. So this also will be the another positive quantity. So it is a trivial case of taking this as 0. So I have to take this term as 0, and I have to look at it, what this term is 0, that is minus 4 times 1 minus omega by omega n square into omega by omega n plus 4 into 2, 8 c square omega by omega n, that should be equal to 0. So this I divide it by 4 times omega by omega n on either side. So I will have minus of 1 minus omega by omega n whole square plus 2 C square is equal to 0. So I can say that 1 minus omega by omega n square is equal to 2 C square. So I will have here omega by omega n square is equal to plus 1 goes minus, so we'll have 1 minus 2 C square. So what I will have is omega by omega n is going to be root of 1 minus 2 C square. Now you see that with this value of omega by omega n, you will have the q as max. So it is not the omega by omega n equal to 1 at which you get q is max, but it is root of 1 minus 2 c square. Yes, if c is 0, if c is 0, what will happen is this term will become 0, so omega by omega n equal to 1. When the damping ratio is 0, the resonance will occur at omega by omega equal to 1. But if the damping ratio is increased, then obviously it is not going to be at 1. Okay? So that will be slightly less than 1. As it increases, the value increases, it will be shifted. So the peak value, it will be initially at 1, after that it will be slightly shifted. As it, the damping ratio is increased, it will be less than 1. Slightly less than 1, at which the maximum will occur. It is not when it is at 0. Okay? So, when it is not 1, it is decided by this particular damping ratio. Okay? So, also, if you go and substitute this here, you will get what is the value of Q max. Okay, so what will be the value of, if you substitute that by yourself, you will find that, you know, I'll substitute that this thing here. So that is not going to be difficult. So Q max will be equal to 1 minus 1 minus 1 by, see, I have to say that 1 minus omega by omega n the whole square. So omega by omega n is, I have to substitute that omega by omega n is equal to root of 1 minus 2 C square. So if I substitute here, I'll get this square will be, this root goes out to 2c square plus 4c square times, then omega minus, so this is again square, 1 minus 2c square whole to the power minus half. So that is your this thing. So 1 and 1 will cancel. You have 2c square plus, you have 4c square minus 8c to the power 4. Oh, yeah, whole square, correct. No, no, that whole square is here. Here you have a whole square, right? No, this one. Oh, yeah. Ah, right. Whole square, correct. So this, the whole square means 2c square. So this will be equal to 4c to the power of 4 plus 4c square minus 8c to the power 4. So this will be like 4 to the power, you have minus half all the time. So this is your 4c square minus 4c to the power 4 to the power of minus half. So you will take this 4 c square outside, so that will be 1 minus c square, okay, to the power minus half, or you can write this as so you have q max is equal to 1 by 4 c square 1 minus c square square root. So you will have, you can take 2 c outside, so this is 1 divided by 2 c root of 1 minus c square. So this will be your max, q max. So again, q max depends on the value of c, okay. So depending on your damping, the q max is again decided. If you increase the damping, q max value will come down.
Sir,
which one?
Yeah.
Critical means what? The c is equal to 1. Okay. C is equal to 1 means this will become 0. So this will be infinity. No. No, it cannot be. 1 minus c square. So you are 2c, this q max. As you see here, as you take c is equal to 1, it is going. Okay, but if c is equal to 1, this becomes 0, then it may become infinity. But it is not, so I have to check it up. Okay, rightly pointed out, if I take it as this as 1, this goes to infinity, that should not be the case. Okay. If it is c is straight away 0, yes, it goes to infinity. So I will check this one.
So that means increasing the damping is not always effective. It will also.
No, don't come to the conclusion. I have to check and answer you, because as the c is more, it is always less than 1. That is the case. But you have to see. I have to come out with the answer for that. So any other question? So we have a question asked here. What happens when c is equal to 1? So we have to look at that. So the interesting thing is, in real world application, when the system is operated near or equal to the resonant frequency, every cycle energy is being added to the system and energy will build up. So the deflection go as high as 50 times. Okay. So if you continue to operate for quite long time, everything will collapse. So unfortunately, you know, we didn't have that, you know, the camera phones and all these things a few years back. So we were asked to check up one stone crusher. So near Perambalur, there is a stone crusher industry. So the crusher was built on a concrete structure. So if you imagine, this is the columns of concrete structure, this is the ground. So your concrete crushing machine was placed on the top. This is about one story high, that is about 10 feet high. There was a crusher which is working. They asked to, you know, the whole structure was vibrating excessively. So we are asked to find out what is the reason. So when we visited there, when they operated it, virtually the whole structure was moving by 1 meter. You cannot imagine. So it was moving like this vigorously, Then one of our colleagues with the civil department also accompanied us. So we found that when they digged this earth near, they found that the concrete, this thing, everything is cracked. So the whole structure was standing on the steel reinforcement. Concrete has given away because of this vibration. Only steel reinforcement was standing. So at that time we didn't have, it's a very classic example of resonance. How the resonance, the natural frequency of the structure and the operating frequency of this machine coincided, then it produced, slowly when you operate for over a period of time, then the whole structure has cracked. But quite unfortunately, we didn't have the so-called the camera phones or cameras with us at the time. So otherwise, we would have taken that whole structure oscillating. So that was a classic example of operating your machine at the resonance. Okay? Yes.